Donc bien, bonjour Emma, donc heureux de te retrouver ici après cette période de chercheur invité que tu as passé au sein de l'équipe PDS du labo. Et ben voilà, donc on t'écoute pour que tu nous présentes tes travaux en cours et ceux que tu as réalisés quand tu étais chez nous.
Merci Nicolas. Bonjour à tous et à toutes. I will do this presentation in English, so I hope that's fine. Welcome to this seminar on accessible digital musical instruments, design and evaluation of musical interfaces for preverbal children with profound and multiple learning disabilities. And in this presentation, I will discuss a couple of different projects that I've been working on during my postdoc at IRCAM and at KTH Royal Institute of Technology starting from fall 2020 and onwards. And this research was funded by the Swedish Research Council's International Postdoc Grant for research carried out in Paris within the Perception and the Sound Design team at SMS and in Stockholm within the Sound and Music Computing Group at KTH. The work that I will present today is published in three papers and one book chapter. The three papers are all case studies focused on accessible musical interfaces for preverbal children with profound and multiple learning disabilities, PMLD. And the first paper is very long, so a big chunk of this presentation will be dedicated to that part, and also paper two and three kind of build. The last publication focuses more on methodologies for evaluation of musical interfaces, which is a topic that was highly relevant for all of the other papers. And none of this research would have been possible without the contributions of my colleagues and my collaborators. So apart from thanking everyone at IRCAM for hosting me during my postdoc period, especially the PDS team, I would also like to thank Esther Trautmann and all of the students and the teaching assistants at the school Liberullen, who kindly participated in all of our user studies throughout the years. And I would also like to thank Claudio Panariello, Claudia Nunez-Pacheco, Hans Lindetorp, Kjetil Falkenberg, Maria Svahn, Josefine Hölling, and Giuseppe Pisano, who all have contributed to the work that I will present here today. So starting off, I just want to briefly mention the definition of accessible digital musical instruments, or ADMIs, since this is a term that will be reappear throughout the seminar. The definition of ADMIs that I proposed in 2019 was accessible musical control interfaces used in electronic music practice, inclusive music practice, and music therapy settings. And this is the overarching theme of this presentation. The first project that I would like to present is summarized in a paper published in Multimodal Technologies and Interactions. And this was a collaborative work that involved different stakeholders, including the Swedish Museum of Performing Arts and students and teachers at the school Liberullen in Solna, Sweden. And this was a long-term project that spanned over 1.5 years. And I should also mention that most of this work was carried out during the COVID-19 pandemic. This project focused on a specific group of students, one teacher, and a group of teaching assistants at the school Liberullen. And Liberullen is a school for students with intellectual challenges and multifunctional physical challenges. So in Swedish, we would call this an anpassad grundskola. The English translation is a compulsory school for pupils with intellectual disabilities. Our research was carried out as activities within the school's standard curriculum during music and craft lessons in small group settings. And the overall goal of the project was to explore the role of haptic feedback in musical interactions in sound installations for a group of children with profound and multiple learning disabilities. So profound and multiple learning disabilities, which is abbreviated PMLD, is a term commonly used to describe a person with severe learning disabilities who most likely have other complex disabilities and health conditions, although there is no single universally agreed definition of the term. There are potential benefits of multisensory musical experiences for children with PMLD, but this is still relatively unexplored, and there are rather few publications on the topic. The group of students that we collaborated with consisted of four children aged 9 to 15, They are mostly pre-verbal, meaning that they do not yet have verbal communication skills. They have multifunctional physical disabilities with varying motor skills and moderate to severe intellectual disabilities, and they all use wheelchairs. The communication between the teachers and the students at the school is based on a tool that is called POD, Pragmatic Organization Dynamic Display. And this is an augmentative and alternative communication method and a way of organizing word and symbol vocabulary to support understanding. So POD is usually in the form of a book, or it can also be an electronic device that contains different symbols and words, as you can see in these pictures. And POD allows the pre-verbal students to point on pictures to communicate with the teaching assistants and the teachers. So in our research, we have explored how POD can be used in communication supporting the participatory design process when designing multisensory experiences. Unfortunately, I cannot show you the videos from the actual project because of data protection reasons. Here's another video. It's a short video just displaying a class at the Dibber school. And the teaching assistants here are moving with the students, accompanied by music. So this is just to give you an example of activities focused on music that could take place at the school. So hopefully there will also be sound now. So the need for participatory design methods, so that is to actively include users as co-designers and informants in design processes, has been stressed in the field of HEI. However, very little work has explored how pre-verbal children with PMLD can be more involved in these kind of processes. So that was something that we wanted to explore in this project. How can we design musical experiences for these children, and how can they act as informants? And how can we also actively involve them in the design process? The final goal of this study was to customize a multisensory experience of the sound installation Sound Forest, or Ljudskogen, which can be seen in this picture. And this installation is situated here at the Swedish Museum of Performing Arts in Stockholm. Sound Forest is a long-term project between researchers in the Sound and Music Computing Group at KTH, Royal Institute of Technology, and the Swedish Museum of Performing Arts. It's a multisensory installation that enables visitors to create sounds by interacting with light-emitting strings, for example, by hitting or plucking a string using the hand. The visitors can also feel the music through their body while receiving visual feedback from the strings. So this is a picture of the installation room when it's inactive. The installation consists of five strings that are attached from the ceiling to the floor, five loudspeakers, and five contact microphones set up to detect sound onsets on the strings. There are also 10 tactile transducers and two mirrored walls in the room. So there is audio coming from speakers located above the interactive strings, indicated with arrows in this picture. And there is also sound and haptic feedback coming from these circular platforms in the floor. So if you stand on these platforms, or if you roll onto them with a wheelchair, you can feel the vibrations of the music being played through your body. And we wanted to customize and also evaluate a multisensory music experience in this installation for this particular group of children at the school. So unfortunately, I cannot show you the actual videos and the pictures from the current study, or the main experiment that we did. But here is another video from one of the previous studies that we did in this room with another group of children, just to give an idea of how the interactions could what the interactions could look like in the installation. So So to include users with disability into user-centered design processes, existing co-design methods may need to be extended and adapted. And these kind of adaptations are particularly important when you're working with children with PMLD, since the communication between the designers and the users can be affected. So co-designing with students with PMLD should take into account that these children may express themselves through a number of different communication methods, depending on what is actually most efficient for them at the time. So they can use bodily gestures, nonverbal sounds, pointing, and facial expressions, for example. And to achieve our goal of creating a customized multisensory experience informed by these students' needs, musical preferences, and their abilities, we used participatory design with proxies. And this is a method that allows for different proxies to provide valuable insights and feedback to augment the direct input from the children. So in this case, the parents and the teachers are augmenting the input that we got from the students. An important aspect of this work was to explore tools and methods that could successfully enable a discussion about music and haptics with these students. In other words, how can we talk about concepts such as the perception of touch using augmentative and alternative communication tools like POLT? A key consideration was to adapt our methodology to the school's pedagogical practice and to make sure that all of the steps of the research were well adapted to the students' needs and preferences. So the final design of the multisensory experience that we developed for the installation was evaluated through an experiment with music presented in haptic versus non-haptic conditions. But in order to get to this final design, we first had to carry out a set of pre-studies, which findings could inform the design that we're then gonna set up at the museum. So there were a lot of different things that needed to be considered here, especially since this work was done during the COVID-19 pandemic. So for a long time, we couldn't actually meet the students. So we had to develop a bunch of new strategies to test things out at the school with the help from the teachers without us actually being there. So for our pre-studies, we mainly used video conferencing tools and different types of recorded videos. So thanks to the help and support from the teacher at the school who filmed the interactions taking place there, we could carry out our work in the wild. And once the final restrictions were lifted, we could also finally meet the students to test the design on site at the museum. And this final experiment on site at the museum was actually the only physical encounter that we had with the student group for this particular study. So I will not describe all of the different pre-studies in detail because there's quite a lot to say about it, but I can just mention that we first did a physical characterization of the vibrating platforms in the installation. So I don't know if you saw in the picture, but there are four smaller platforms, and then there is one that is a bit larger. And we wanted to understand the frequency responses of these platforms to be able to design haptic sensations that would make sense. Other things that we did was that we sent out questionnaires to the parents of the students to find out more about the students' musical interests and their preferences, and also if they played any musical instruments at home, for example. We also managed to attend classes remotely, for example, sessions where they were dancing and focusing more on music. And then the teacher also helped us to organize music listening sessions with a wide range of different sonic stimuli. And this was something that we did just to understand what kind of music that they actually liked and what kind of sounds that also were not that very much appreciated by the student group. And finally, we also managed to introduce this idea of haptic music using pod cards and the pod vocabulary with the students. But I will talk more about that later since it's more the focus of the second paper. So in the interest of time, I will not go into all of the details about what we can conclude from all of these different pre-studies, but one aspect that was worth maybe mentioning is that for the physical characterization of the platforms that are in the installation, we had, of course, frequency responses, and as expected, we found differences in resonances between depending on the platform size, but also we could see that there was a difference in terms of if you were standing on the platform, or if you were lying down, or if you were sitting in a wheelchair. And this was, of course, important to think about when we're designing sounds, since these children are actually sitting in wheelchair when interacting mostly in installation. Other aspects that are worth mentioning was that we observed some differences in terms of how the students would move to the music. And most of the students would use hand gestures and also upper body movements to express themselves, but some of them also use their legs. Overall, we noticed at the school that there seemed to be a strong focus on dance and music with kind of clear rhythm. But we also noticed that when we played other types of music that had more kind of complex structure or more soundscape sounds, that these sounds were actually very popular also among the students. So based on what we learned from all of these pre-studies, where we also found that the students actually really liked nature sounds, we decided to go for a sound design that reminded of a calm and relaxing forest. And all of the sounds were programmed in SuperCollider, and they consisted of both processed pre-recorded sound samples and fully synthesized sounds. Oh, that was too fast. Yeah, I think here I wanted to just play a little video, but I'm not sure if it's working. Anyway, for the interaction with the sounds, we used the sound of a singing bowl, and we also had a synthesized wooden-like percussive instrument sound. So the wooden-like sound was built from a bank of resonators tuned to resemble the timbre of a percussive instrument in between the timbre of a low marimba and a luzhong, which is a bass metallophone with a wooden box resonator. So when a string in the installation is hit, the two sounds are played simultaneously, and the sound of the singing bowl is played by the string's ceiling speaker, so basically above the string, and the wooden synthesized sound is played both by the ceiling speaker and the actuators that are in the floor. And the amplitude of both of these sounds were fixed, so we did not map them to the amplitude of these onsets or the interaction with the string. And this design choice was made to allow all students to experience the same sound output and vibration level, regardless of how much force that they would actually use to hit the string. So we decided to do it like this because there were some differences in terms of manual dexterity among the different students. So I will try to play this little video to illustrate the interaction. Hopefully this works. So for the light design, we decided to insist on this metaphor of a forest. So the strings were glowing in a green color, and when an interaction with the string occurred, it became more brighter, and it was supposed to be purple. It looks more white in these videos, but it's actually purple, and then it's eventually fading back to green again. So also the more frequently that you hit a string, so if the time between detected onsets is decreasing, the higher the pitches of the produced sound. So if the time then between two consecutive hits decreases again, the pitches slowly go back to the fundamental ones. So this was one way of getting mapping the sound to change, even though, for example, we didn't map it to the amplitude. All of the five strings in the installation worked in the same way, and the only difference was that the starting pitches of the singing bowl sounds were different for different strings. And the different starting pitches all belong to the same musical mode, so this allowed the students to play together without creating redundant or cacophonous results. For a more immersive experience in the installation, we also added two additional sounds, two background sounds. And the first sound was a natural soundscape. And this is an excerpt from recording of an environment in South Italy. And the sound was played back in a loop from the ceiling speakers. And then we also had a second background sound, which was inspired by the students' music listening sessions, where we had noticed that they actually really liked ambient or drone-like pieces, which was something that we didn't expect. But as long as there was some kind of evolution over time, or variation over time, it seems that these sounds were popular. So therefore, we created a generative ambient background based on digital processing of the same sample of the singing bowl sound. And this was played through the ceiling speakers, but also through the floor actuators. And the result of this design is that there's haptic feedback playing continuously and independently from the interaction with the strings. So this guaranteed an evolving vibration from the floor for the haptic conditions, regardless of how much the students would actually interact with the string. So I will just play a short excerpt of what an interaction with one string could sound like with all of these different components. And this particular example is resynthesized from the data that we collected from the experiment. So this is actually the interaction of one final student. So here you should be able to also, hopefully in the room, also hear the background sounds a little bit more clear. So the student group and the teacher, as well as three teaching assistants, were finally invited to the SoundForce installation to explore this multisensory experience. And when they first arrived, the students had a couple of minutes to familiarize themselves with the room and the sounds, because this was, of course, a very new experience. And we also then put the wheelchairs on top of respective platforms so that the students could reach the strings. And then the students stayed with the same string and platform throughout the experiment. And three of the students used a small platform, and one student used a larger platform. We had a total of 20 minutes of music that was divided into four conditions. And each condition was 5 minutes long and was followed by a pause in when we turned off the music, but there was also silence in the room, so we turned on the lights. The different conditions were sitting in a wheelchair with haptics off, so there was music but no haptics, and also sitting in a wheelchair but with haptic feedback. And then we had two additional conditions when they were removed from the wheelchairs, but they were on the floor, so they could lie down or sit on the floor, and there was haptics off, and then the same thing but with haptics on. And this particular condition order was chosen to minimize the number of times that the students actually had to be lifted into or out of the wheelchair, because it takes a little bit of time. And the order was also flipped for students so that we could investigate if there was an effect of starting with haptics versus without haptics. After each haptic condition, the teacher proxies filled out the body map questionnaires that we had. And this was done to highlight in which kind of body parts that the students would actually perceive the musical vibrations, and also to ask the students if they liked the vibrations or not. So these questions were asked using POD. And generally speaking, a body map is kind of an image of a human body, as in this figure. So the body map questionnaire included also, apart from this image, it also included a question that was posed to the teacher proxies. In terms of, so the exact question was, do you interpret it as though the student liked or disliked the vibrations? And please describe if there was anything in particular that the students expressed that they liked or disliked. When not busy with other tasks, the three researchers that were present during the experiment also focused on observing the interactions that were taking place in the room. So this allowed us to also collect a little bit more data, what was actually happening. And this is maybe a little bit messy slide, but it's a summary of all of the data collection for the entire project. During the actual final experiment in the installation, we collected audio, we also collected video. The entire session was filmed with four stationary video cameras, so we had one for each student and platform. But in order to also capture the students' nonverbal communication, so for example, facial and body expressions when communicating with the teachers' proxies about what they perceived, we also had two researchers who were invited to act as mobile camera operators. So there were four stationary cameras, but there were also two other cameras that focused on the haptic conditions, filming what was actually happening when there was haptic feedback. Apart from that, we also logged timestamps and amplitudes of every detected onset for each string. And after the experiment, we conducted a semi-structured group interview with the teacher proxies. And the interview used a stimulated recall methodology. So this means that we had videos from the experiments, and we used these videos to stimulate the commentary upon the thought process at that time. So the teacher proxies were shown one video clip from each condition and student, and then they were asked what was actually happening in that particular instance and how they interpret the students' reactions. And for the haptic conditions, we also had these body map questionnaires that we could use. So this allowed us for to do visual inspection of these maps. And the purpose of this step was to try to collect richer information about the communication between the teacher proxies and the students regarding what they liked or didn't like when it comes to musical haptics. And after commenting on these videos, we just concluded this session with the interviews with six open-ended questions focused on accessibility, more generally speaking, of the installation to understand how we could redesign the experience to be more accessible to children with limited movement in the future. So for the observations that we also made in the room during the experiment, we used microphenomenological interviews to explore some potential tensions and overlaps arising from the interpretation of the attitudes and body language of the students. So the observers all had different roles in the project and they could therefore contribute with different perspectives. I think I will not go into detail about this since the analysis was done by my colleague Claudia, but all of the information is available in the paper. So using the collected onset data from the strings, we could resynthesize the sounds created by each student for each condition. And we also generated temporal plots representing these interactions. All recorded videos were then segmented for each condition. So I labeled a bunch of different points in these recordings to try to understand what was happening. So I, for example, I labeled the interactions with the strings, the pod discussions, the other kinds of gestural expressions like arm and leg movements, clapping and waving the hands, and also non-vocal expressions, so sounds that were not verbal sounds. And interactions with the strings were also labeled based on the strategy used to trigger a sound. So this was inspired by exploratory procedures in object exploration, as well as other strategies that we have identified in previous work in Sound Forest. So basically, I labeled if they were plucking, pulling, or shaking, or for example, muting the string. And the total number of onsets performed by the student versus the teacher proxies was also counted manually using a click counter. And this was done since it's not possible just now to know from the recorded data and the log data if actually the interactions were triggered by the student or the teacher. So the software, of course, doesn't know who's actually playing on the string, just that someone is playing. And then we checked also the total duration of the interaction for each student and condition. So for the analysis of all this data that we had for the interviews, we transcribed them manually. And for the first part of the interview that focused on these videos and the stimulate and recall, I used content analysis to group quotes into themes. And then for the second part of the interview, which was the kind of concluding questions, we summarized the responses per question. And the microphenomenological, very difficult word, interviews were analyzed by Claudia using thematic analysis, and transcription were read several times in search of patterns. So moving on to the results, here we have a figure that illustrates the interactions in two different conditions for student four, I think it is. So on the x-axis here, we have the timestamp, and on the y-axis with the blue dots, we have the onset amplitude when hitting the string. And on the y-axis, in red lines, we have the selected singing bowl semitones. So basically, there are many ways of looking at this, but we can just add a very small spectrogram here, for example, to get an idea of how the sounds were distributed over time. And we can also zoom in on different parts, for example, this beginning of this condition. So in this little box, we can see that we have a bunch of notes that eventually go up in pitch, and then the box will just finish with a few notes that are on the same pitch, followed by one note at the original pitch at the bottom. So this sounds like this. hopefully. So all of this is, of course, easier to see if you have the spectrograms in real time, but this is just to illustrate how the suns were mapped and all of the data that we kind of collected. When it comes to the interactions with the strings during the different conditions, we could not see any clear difference in terms of answers for haptic versus non-haptic conditions, which was maybe a little bit of a surprise, but also we had very few participants and the experiment was rather short. A summary of the different interaction strategies that were used by respective students is presented in this table. So what we can see here is basically that the students used rather different interaction strategies. The different methods used to trigger sounds are seen here in the left of this table, and the student number or the participant is more to the right, so P1 to P4. The primary or most commonly used strategies to create sounds were also different for the different students. So the first student held the string using two hands. The second student enclosed the string with one hand, basically like this. And the third student mainly struck the string using the hand, more like this kind of gesture. And student four mostly pulled the string, so this is more like this. And interestingly, student four also used his head, and he also tried to bite the string to make sounds. But there were also some strategies that were present for all students, as we can see in this table. And some other data that was interesting was that we could see that when we looked at the onsets over time, that there were fewer onsets in general as we go to the right side of this table. So the students got more and more tired, and then they interacted less. So there was a tendency towards fatigue as the experiment progressed, even though the sessions were as short as 5 minutes for each condition. Body maps filled out for the haptic condition when sitting in the wheelchair are presented in this figure. And these results can be compared to the body maps for the haptic condition when sitting or lying on the floor, as seen in this figure here below. So the green emojis in this picture are representing that the students said that they liked it, and the orange one is when they said that they didn't like. There are some that have both like and dislike, and that's when that is in situations when it was a little bit unclear what was happening, or when there were discrepancies between what was being said and what was communicated. Basically communication with the teacher proxies. So comparing these two figures, we can see that the annotation seems to be different for the two conditions, for at least for student one, two, and four. For student three, it's basically the same. And we can also see that all students had annotations in the head region for the haptic condition in the wheelchair. Annotations for the haptic condition on the floor involved more regions overall. However, student two, three, and four still had annotations in the kind of head region also for this condition. We can also see that both student one and four had annotations in the middle region of the body. And when we discussed this with the teacher and the teaching assistants, we understood that the annotations for student number four here actually referred to the belly, whereas student one's annotation was referring to a location on the back of the body. So this was a little bit confusing. And we also saw that student two had more detailed annotations with descriptive text mentioning the head and the face, the legs and the knees. And student four had several annotations, four in total, including both of the hands. So a summary of the themes discussed during the stimulant and recall interview is presented in this table. And one of the most commonly used strategies when interpreting the videos was to describe interactions by referring to previously displayed behaviors at the school. So this really highlights that we, as researchers and observers in this experiment, we do not interpret the situations in the same way as the teachers does. They do, of course, they have a lot of experience from things that they have seen at the school, and they're going to use that to interpret what actually is going on. Another common theme that we discussed was the interpretation of body maps in relation to pod images. So there were situations in which these tools seems to work really well to communicate felt experiences, but also examples of contexts when it was a bit more challenging to interpret the responses. And the discussion highlighted the importance of actually the exact representation and text that was printed on these pod images. So, for example, there was a discussion about the image of a foot in the pod book in relation to a student's body map. So, since the pod image depicts actually a single foot, the students would have to, for example, point to their own feet to describe that they were talking about both feet, if that's what they wanted to communicate about. And we had also a similar discussion about the ear annotation of the on one of the body maps. So of course, if you have an annotation on the ear, it's a little bit tricky to know if this symbolizes that the students that they were actually hearing sounds, or if this is some kind of sensation or vibration that they felt in the head. So to summarize, we can conclude from what can actually be concluded from all of this very perhaps rich, but also somewhat messy data. First of all, the sound design that we used in the experiment appeared to work pretty well in terms of creating a relaxing and ever-changing sonic experience, with a constant yet not overwhelming vibration coming from the haptic floor. And overall, the student seemed to like the experience. And based on the feedback from the teachers, it even seemed that the vibrations could have been even more strong in the room. We were a little bit afraid that they wouldn't like it and that it would be unpleasant or something like that, but that was not the case at all. And findings also highlighted that there were some limitations in terms of the accessibility of the current multisensory experience design. So some students interacted much more than others, managed to trigger more sounds than others, for example. There was also a kind of wide diversity in the employed interaction strategies that were used. And we could not conclude that there was a clear difference between haptic and non-haptic conditions. Rather, we observed large interpersonal differences in terms of interaction strategies, duration of play, and the total number of sound-producing onsets. We also observed a tendency towards fatigue as the experiment progressed, at least for three participants. This, of course, further complicates attempts to draw conclusions about differences between conditions. So, overall, using pod and body maps to communicate about musical haptics seemed to work well. There were some limitations, but in generally speaking, it seemed like we could just adjust this procedure a little bit and that it would work pretty well. We understood that we perhaps needed to have two body maps, so one on the front and one of the back. And the interview with the teaching assistants also highlighted that this aspect of using prior knowledge about the students to kind of interpret what was going on in the installation. And then during the discussion about the concluding questions focused on accessibility, we also got very valuable information and feedback about how we could make this installation more accessible for children with limited movement. There were, of course, many limitations to this work, but in the interest of time, I think I will not go through this and I will just skip to the next paper. So the second paper is called Haptic Music Players for Children with Profound and Multiple Learning Disabilities, and it is actually one of the pre-studies from the last paper. And it focuses on a 6-month exploratory case study on the evaluation of three haptic music players, or HMPs, for four children from the same school. So this was published as a conference paper in the proceedings of the International Congress on Acoustics. And the purpose of this study was to explore design considerations for HMPs for this group of children. And more specifically, the aim was to allow for exploration of musical haptics using customized devices that could be tested by the students in a safe and familiar environment without leaving the actual educational setting. Haptic music players, or HMPs, are devices that can process an audio signal to extract musical information and translate the information into a vibratory signal. So they can be considered sensory substitution systems that translate information that is normally available via one sense to another one. So in this case, there's a translation going on between hearing and touch. HMPs allow for enhancement of music listening experiences through simultaneous playback of haptic feedback. So the project started off with an introductory meeting or workshop with the teacher to demonstrate to existing haptic music players the Humu augmented audio cushion and the Voudjeur strap edge. And the teacher got to test these devices on different body parts. And we also played different music examples and discussed appropriateness of these tools for the specific user group. So in particular, we focus on how the HMPs should be designed to best take the physical abilities of the students into account and which modes of interaction, so which parts of the body basically that might work well for these kids. And the outcome of this meeting was a set of design constraints. So when we talked to the teacher, we quickly realized that these devices, they have to be very robust and durable since they might be thrown to the floor. And another thing that was clear was that cables are very interesting for many of these children, and the cables invite naturally to play. So we had to keep that in mind. It's good to keep these devices wireless, or if you have cables, to have cables that are very durable that can be pulled without breaking actually the device. So other aspects that we discussed was that this Voudjeur strap, which is a strap that you put on the body usually to feel vibrations, that it looks a little bit like a ball, and that this would further maybe encourage you to throw it if you're for the students in the at the school. And something that we also discussed was that one approach of designing HMPs could be to maybe attach actuators to something that would be wooden, that in turn could be embedded into some kind of fluffy material. So this would allow you to create something that would invite to touch, but still you would have a transmission of vibrations. And most importantly, you would be able to throw it to the other side of the room without the risk of damaging the haptic actuators. So after this meeting, we basically concluded that we could use the Humu cushion as it is, but that we needed to embed the Voudjeur strap edge into something else. And we also concluded that it would be good if we would create our own customized HMP. So we continued with the customization versus development of these three different HMP solutions. That then would be tested with the students at the school. And after that, we plan to interview the teacher again about how the tests that she actually performed with the students, how they went and what they liked and disliked. So here are the final HMPs that we used. The first one is just the Humu cushion. And the second one is actually the Voudjeur strap edge, but it's in the bed, embedded into a modified plush toy backpack. So it's a plush toy, but it's also a backpack, so you can hang it on your back if you want to. And the third HMP is a custom-built plush toy with a built-in speaker and tactile shaker. So we wanted to use different devices to explore different ways of sensing haptic vibrations on the body. Since these kind of different designs naturally invite to different types of interactions, and you can put them on different spots of the body, for example. And some of them you can put the head on, some of them you can put maybe it's better to have on a table and pass it around. So this is just some tech specs for the different HMPs. This is the cushion. It has an embedded vibrating soundboard assembly with a sound and vibration frequency from 20 to 22,000 hertz. It plays stereo. And of course, this one is so kind of padded as it is that we didn't need to embed it in anything else. It could just be used like that. The second HMP we had to work a little bit on. We had to do several iterations because we wanted to embed this haptic device, but first we kind of used headphones, and then there were to set it up. It was a little bit complicated for the teachers to test the Bluetooth, and then you have audio, but then you also have vibrations, so it didn't really work well. So we ended up doing a new solution with duct tape, and we had an external small speaker that was just embedded and like attached to the actual haptic device, and therefore, and then we just embedded everything inside of the backpack, and that worked a lot better. And the third haptic music player is this kind of customized Chewbacca that we built. It's inspired by Chewie from Star Wars, and it's actually a small wooden napkin box with it embedded in a lot of different layers of protective foam, and then we covered it in a textile fake fur material. And to give it a little bit more of an animalistic character, we decorated it with glass eyes and a round speaker cover that would symbolize the mouth. So the sound is coming out of the mouth of Chewbacca. But then there's also a tactile puck, a tactile transducer inside of the box. And you can connect all of this through Bluetooth, and there are only a few cables connected to an amp that we could put very far away from the actual haptic music player. So since we couldn't attend these kind of test sessions at the school in person because it was during COVID, we asked the teacher to film the interactions that took place at the school. And the teacher had 6 months to test out the different HMPs with the students. And the teacher managed to test each HMP at least 2 times each. And there were also other teaching assistants present during these kind of test sessions to help out and ask the students what they liked and what they didn't like, and which parts of the body that they wanted to feel the haptic vibrations, and so on. After that, we carried out 3 semi-structured interviews with the teacher to discuss what was observed during the evaluation sessions. And we also analyzed the videos that had been recorded by the teacher at the school. There was an entire protocol for this these different interviews, since we didn't have so much time, and we had it to really be structured to try to get out as much information as possible from these sessions. But generally speaking, we started off the interview with questions regarding the music that was used and how many times the interfaces were used, and so on. And this was followed up by questions that focused more on aspects related to functionality, accessibility, and user experience. And this kind of categorization was just broadly inspired by evaluation methods used in HAI and digital and musical instrument research. So we were initially not sure if there would be a need to create new pod pictures to be able to discuss musical haptics with the students, but we could, after these interviews, identify a set of existing pod symbols that could be used to discuss musical haptics with the students. So this was a very important step. And we also concluded that the students managed to successfully explore musical haptics using the first HMP and the third one, so both the pillow and the Chewbacca one, and also in the second iteration of the one that was embedded into the backpack. On average, the time spent exploring the HMPs was 10 minutes, so pretty short. And the teacher had tested a range of different sounds, not only the sounds that we had provided. We had sent them a playlist of sounds that would include a lot of low frequency content. But they also had tested a bunch of other things. For example, they listened to animal sounds, whale sounds, and the sound of a bear in Chewbacca, because that made sense to them since it kind of looks like a bear. So to conclude, our results suggested that the students managed to actively engage with the three haptic music players using different modes of listening. And the dominating interaction strategy was exploration using the hands. And this was also a strategy that enabled the students to clearly push away the HMP if they didn't like it. So it's a very clear sign that you touch something, but then you can push it from you if it's not a pleasant sensation for the child. There were differences in functionality, accessibility, and user experience for the three different HMPs. And the one that it was a little bit tricky to say which worked the best, but generally speaking, it seemed like the teacher thought that the Chewbacca one was the one that worked best overall. And the one thing that was also important that we can conclude was this, that this was a very novel interaction for this for these children. So you need to allow for extra time to get acquainted with these haptic music players. So all of the devices, regardless of which one it was, were met with skepticism by the students when used on the first time, and then it got better. But this entire experience was perhaps very a little bit confusing, and the students are not maybe used to listening to music or the sensation of touch and musical haptics. So you need to take that into consideration so that there's time for repetition and to get used to this entire idea. And other conclusions were that the physical affordances and touch and feel of these HMPs were very important. So these devices should ideally invite the children to touch and to play. And if they do, that seems to work better. One thing to think about that is that for a school setting, several different devices could be used. So this would allow for both individual and collaborative use. So one thing that we discussed with the teacher was, for example, that you could have a haptic device that is attached to a table, and that way you can have multiple students around the table that can feel the music, or you can have something that you send around on the table. Finally, one thing that should be said is that this is kind of an in the wild study, and it's based on that the students are working with the teachers and the teacher are setting up the haptic music players, so there is no researcher involved. So you have to really provide really good documentation, and the systems have to be really easy to set up. And ideally, this works a lot better, we noticed when we had demonstrated the devices in person before the first use. So I think I have maybe 10 more minutes left, so we'll see how much time I will have for the two remaining papers. But the third paper that I would like to discuss is called Collaborative Music Making, Special Educational Needs School Assistants as Facilitators in Performances with Accessible Digital Musical Instruments. And it was published in Frontiers in Computer Science. And the first author of this paper is Hans Lindetorp from KMH Royal College of Music in Stockholm. So this work was carried out in collaboration with the same school and the same group of students, but also with a startup called Funky Instruments. So in this paper, we describe the context-specific design and evaluation of a master controller instrument developed for the teaching assistants at the same school. So more specifically, we explored how such an interface should be designed to support the assistants' roles as facilitators in a musical performance with a group of students who are playing ADMIs together with a professional musician. So for this study, we used ADMIs that are called Funky instruments, and they are tangible instruments that allow for different modes of interaction to create sound by physically engaging with sliders, buttons, and touchpads. And all of these, they are all kind of in wooden boxes. And these instruments have previously been used by the same students at the same school, but in a context without a professional musician. And one of the conclusions from this previous work was that the teaching assistants significantly influenced the music making sessions. So therefore, we wanted to explore this role of the teaching assistants a bit further and not only focus on the technology aspect of ADMIs. So the background to this work is the growing body of research stressing the importance of shifting focus from the technical aspects of DMIs to more sociocultural contexts in which musical interactions are actually taking place. And this study was part of a longer project with the overall goal of organizing a joint concert that brings together students from the school with some other students who are not living with disabilities. And so other students that are enrolled in a music school focus on more traditional orchestral instruments. So this research was largely inspired by the term facilitated performance and the idea of having a very inclusive orchestra. So to reach this kind of general goal, multiple challenge of creating an environment where you can play together, these children at this school, but also the other one. Multiple challenges would need to be addressed, and we wanted to explore some of them in this paper. So the setup that we used consisted of four ADMIs. They are three existing Fugge instruments. And then we also had one master instrument that would be used by one of the assistants. And as you can see in this picture, the funky instruments are made of wood and they can be placed on a table or in a wheelchair on your lap. And they have integrated loudspeakers, a microcomputer, and two interactive controllers of the same type. All of these funky instruments are then connected to the master instrument. And this master instrument is intended to be used by the teaching assistants. And it has several important functions. So it stores samples and audio configurations from the different Fugge instruments. It receives control data from them, and it also determines how the assistant can control the composition. And then finally, it also sends out the appropriate sound to each integrated loudspeaker. So the master instrument that was used for the teaching assistant was different from the Fugge instrument in the sense that it was actually had a graphical user interface and it was run, we ran it on a computer. So it can be played on using the space bar on the keyboard. And it didn't have this kind of wooden setting. The idea with the master instrument was that it should not only be easy to play, but it also should allow the system to support the students in their music making. And it should also complement the other instruments with sounds that contribute to the musical context. And by designing a master instrument according to these constraints, we aim to support the assistants to become more actively involved in the music making process, thereby also facilitating the students' performance on their instruments. And the logic that controls how all of this works is based on web technologies, and everything is configured using Web Audio XML. And I will not go into details about this, but there's this paper about that discusses all of the technical aspects that you can find by Hans Lindetorp. So basically, the sounds created by the system was based on having this master instrument that could both trigger sounds in itself and control the pitches of the student's instruments. So the metaphor that kind of inspired us during this process was that of a child strumming guitar strings with then a parent simultaneously changing the chords by moving the finger on the fretboard. So in this way, the master instrument had kind of acted as a harmony controller for the three students, and they all changed pitches according to the rules that was set by the assistants. So we evaluated this system in the form of by conducting a workshop at the school. So we had three students from the school, and then we also had three assistants who tried out the system, and then, so the assistants were actually playing the master instrument. And the aim of this kind of workshop was to explore the interplay between the assistants and also a professional musician, because we wanted to introduce this kind of more concert setting. So we had also a musician playing the accordion who was there during the session and who also communicated with the teaching assistant. So we repeated this kind of process three times with the same students, but we had three different assistants. So the students kept the same instruments in all sessions. So there was a little bit of repetition, but then there was one teaching assistant in each session. We recorded this and then we tracked and analyzed the controller events from the assistant. And this was followed by semi-structured interviews with the assistants and the musician. So there, in these kind of sessions, we focused on how the setup supported inclusive music making in the group and also the assistant's role in this context. Interview was also based on a simulated recall methodology, so we also used video clips. And each interview session included two to three video clips for a total duration of a couple of minutes. So the assistants only watched the clip from their own sessions, and then we had a discussion about what actually happened in the video at that specific time. And there was also a lot of other analysis done that you can find in the paper. The videos were manually tagged to identify mastering storm onsets. And we also had a bunch of more kind of quantitative aspects of these interactions. I will not go into detail about this because there's not much time left, but basically what we could find is that the three different assistants behaved rather differently in their interaction with the musician. And there were also some significant differences, for example, in terms of how long the chords played were. So the qualitative analysis revealed a number of interesting themes. To conclude, I would just like to mention some drivers and barriers that may support music making in or disrupt music making in this context. So design considerations that support teaching assistants as facilitators in this context involved making sure that the students are familiar with the musical instruments. So they all of the students had already played all of these instruments before, so that made it work very well. It's also important to create an environment where the assistants are feeling relaxed so that they can play together with the musician. Repetition is very important. It's important not only to make sure that the students can practice their instruments, but also that the teaching assistants get the chance to actually rehearse before these sessions. And another thing that we discussed was that there's important to maybe this kind of disruption between having different instruments and also a separate computer, which is different for the master instrument, maybe doesn't make much sense. Because actually, when the teachers are working in their daily practice at the school, they usually have, they demonstrate to the kids what they're doing. So it would have perhaps made much more sense to have same boxes for everyone and then same instruments. And then the teachers could actually focus on demonstrating to the students how they would play and do the same thing themselves. Because what we found was that we actually had some kind of split attention in the situation for the teaching assistants who had to look at the musician. They also had to look at the students, but then they also had a different interface. So it's important in this context to limit distracting factors like this. And another thing that we discussed with the teaching assistants was that it was really important also to discuss the body language with the professional musicians, because otherwise they will not understand what they're supposed to do during this session. So with that, I think I'm running out of time. So I will just finish by mentioning that I also wrote a chapter that focused more on evaluation of musical interfaces, specifically musical robots. And it might seem a little bit far-fetched, the link between ADMIs and robots, but it's actually quite linked because there are a bunch of instruments that are considered to be accessible digital musical instruments, but are also robots. And there is a link between accessible music making and in this context. So I can just finish by mentioning that this chapter focuses broadly on how you can take methods from other fields and how you can look at them and try to analyze to understand how you can incorporate such evaluation methods in specific contexts. So the outcome of this paper, I'll just skip all of this. Of this chapter is basically a proposed workflow for evaluation of musical robots based on a bunch of previous literature in different fields ranging from HI to computational creativity and human AI interaction. That could be, and this could be, even if it's focused on general and musical robots, it also is kind of this chapter is an overview of many different evaluation methods used in neighboring fields, which might be of interest to the DMI and NIME evaluation topic. So I think I'm running out of time, but thank you so much for coming and listening. These are all the references, and I am happy to answer questions if there are any now.
Well, thank you, Emma, for this very consistent and interesting presentation. Well, actually, you run a bit out of time, so yes, there may be room for one or two questions. There are some, well, very hot question, I would say. Otherwise, we could also interact. I think you will come back in France and in Attica maybe some times in spring. So I don't know if there are one question or maybe two questions from the audience. Well, maybe just one little question from my side. I didn't get exactly in the HMP study,
Yes.
Haptic Musical Player, who is managing the music that is played. I mean, is it the users themselves, or are there a bunch of music hits or music samples that the users could trigger or choose, etc. Can you give us some detail on that?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I went through it a bit quickly, so perhaps you're a little bit confused. But the idea is basically that these are they are not really interactive devices. They're more kind of passive. So they are playing music and they are vibrating with music. But the idea is that everything is organized by the teachers. So the teachers have these devices and then they have an iPad and they select which music to play because that's usually how they work with music in the school. So we just let the teachers decide themselves exactly what they wanted to play. We gave them some examples of sounds, but then also we let them be free to just pick whatever kind of app they wanted to use to play specific sounds, and in that way they managed to test the different sounds on the different devices.
Okay, thank you. That's more clear for me.
Thank you.
Okay, so maybe if there are no other questions, we could close this seminar, and then, as I said, of course, interactions could occur also afterwards with you, and if you come back, etc. So thank you again, Emma, and
Thank you so much.
have a good day in Stockholm.
Thank you. You too.
Bye-bye.